Please correct that slide. It says Monday, 14th April.
Hey, which slide?
जो
लिंक भेजा है वो?
हाँ.
डेट बराबर है एंड डे रॉन्ग है क्या?
या द सेम.
ओके, अभी ऑलरेडी गया है मैंने लोगों को. आई जस्ट सेंड द इट इज नाउ स्टार्टिंग.
या एंड उस पे ही चेंज कर देना आल्सो सो दैट पीपल सी. एंड Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm here.
Good morning, sir. This is Mansi here.
Yeah, I know.
Sir, your video is not very clear. I think you are having an internet connectivity issue.
Okay.
Sir.
Should I? Okay, I'll try another. I have a thing. Kya ye iska? Jio ka. Let me try that. Or else I'll try the hotspot.
From your cell phone?
Yeah. We'll try all three of them and then you tell me which one is best.
Sure.
So... Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is this better?
1 minute. Let me just enlarge. No, it is still blur. In fact, the first one was better.
Okay.
Maybe what you could do, sir, like maybe you could sit closer to the door or the window, like the balcony gallery.
I think behind me is a lot of bright light. Is that why?
No. That shouldn't be the reason. And if you're sitting next to the balcony or the gallery or...
No. I'm sitting inside.
No, you should sit closer to the gallery or balcony and open it so that you get more network. See if it is possible.
Yeah, Nini, my where I'm sitting right now is just next to the router.
It is next to the router.
Okay. Yeah. So
I thought like maybe we could place the router itself. Okay, you're saying so, connected to the home Wi-Fi.
Yeah, home Wi-Fi. You want me to try the hotspot? I think so
because your smaller video itself is very blur. If you want, I can stop sharing my screen.
No, have a look now. I'm on the hotspot. Is this better?
Yes, this is better. Yes.
Okay. This is better?
Yes, this is better. Definitely.
Okay, then we stick to this. Take care. Okay, I'll just quickly put on my slides and run through them. So that.
Yes. So you have a video in your presentation?
No.
No, okay.
This is all straightforward PowerPoint.
Okay.
Sorry, just give me a minute. I've already opened it. Where is it gone? Got it?
Yes, I can see it.
Okay. And I'm just quickly running through it, just see how the slides show.
Yes.
I've timed it to about 40 minutes, so 40 to 45 minutes.
Yeah, I think we should be okay. We'll also get a lot of questions, I believe.
Yeah. Okay, done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
This slide that I was sharing, is your CV correct? I have picked it up from Hinduja Hospital's website.
Whatever. It's okay. Yeah, and I will, in any case, I have to quit WhatsApp, otherwise I'll get notifications.
Yes.
Okay. So it's off my laptop. Okay. Yes. Network is okay, na?
Yeah. Now it is fine.
Yeah. So the backup is, I have two backups. I have both Jio as well as the home.
Okay. Wi-Fi. Okay.
Okay. So.
I'm sharing your CV now. I mean, as people join,
that's okay.
They're able to see this slide right now.
Yeah. Theek. This is good enough.
This is fine, right?
Yeah, this is fine. So, I'll just take a quick.
Yes.
The restroom break, 2 minutes, and I'm sitting.
Chuck. Yes.
Sudhir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Dr. Kothari is not here yet.
Okay. So 3 minutes more.
Yes, we'll join.
Yeah. I'll just call him.
Sir, also Dr. Param Kharbanda, he is also chairing the session, right?
Yeah, so is he there yet?
Yeah, he is in the attendees. I will move him to panelists.
Sorry, yeah, he should be in the attendees. Yeah, there he is.
Yes.
Okay. So you'll call Sudhir so that then we are about 2 minutes to getting started.
Yeah, I will just talk to him.
स्मार्ट सा फोटो लगा दिया पहले
हाँ नो व्हेन आई व्हेन माय वीडियो गोज ऑफ इट कम्स ऑन ऑटोमेटिकली हाउ आर यू
गुड सो ये एक्चुअली सुधीर पुश्ड एंड आई एंड देन वी स्टार्टेड सो वील डू थ्री ऑफ दिस एंड एज वी गो अलोंग आई विल काइंड ऑफ टेल यू व्हाट द प्लान इज फॉर द अदर टू सो हाँ सुधीर
Okay, so Roop, you want to start trying sharing your
Here it is.
Yes.
Okay. Tell me. Whenever you tell me, I'll get started.
Yeah. Maybe 1 minute more.
Yeah. That's one thing. Huh? This is with this we are on time always.
Yes. This is on time. So see, only difference is between a normal talk and this is that. The speaker is not looking at you. So, in between, once in a while, look at the camera and talk.
Like this?
That makes the audience feel you are looking at them. Huh? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. When you speak like that, you are talking to them. When you look straight at them. Otherwise, you are looking down. It's like you are reading. So, for the slide content, you may have to. But when you are explaining, then look up.
Yeah.
Okay. I think it will go beyond 100. Huh? But we'll start. Sure. You can begin.
Yeah.
I'm muting my and Param's, but Param can introduce you maybe.
Whatever, I mean.
All right.
Dr. Kharbanda, huh? Why don't you introduce Roop?
Yes. All right. Should we start now?
Yeah.
Yes, start by introducing. Yes.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to today morning's webinar on the neurologist's role in the end of life and palliative care. This is talk by Dr. Roop Gursani, who is a consultant neurologist at the PD Hinduja National Hospital, Mumbai. And many of you may know, he has done a pioneering work in India on neuropalliative care. He is responsible for setting up the network and trying to take it forward to all over the country by different meetings and initiating different people, including me, into that. So I think I'll hand over now to Dr. Gursahani for his talk.
Thank you. Thank you, Param. Thank you, Sudhir. It was Sudhir's push that finally made this happen. So let's move on. What is happening? My own involvement with this actually began in 2011 when I was involved in the Aruna Sharma case in the Supreme Court as part of the medical panel. And over a period of time, I went to what is called the Palatucci Advocacy and Leadership Forum of the American Academy of Neurology in 2015. And as I was able to take it somewhat further, my own involvement grew and my realization grew. The first realization was that as a physician, I could not really help my patients till the last. And it hurt me, but repeatedly I had to say this, ab main aur kuch nahi kar sakta. More importantly, as a citizen, I realized that I would probably have no control over my own last days. And this is a Gordian knot. It's a complex situation. There's ethics, there's legislation, there's a politics and the economics of healthcare systems, there's complex medical decision making. And the problem is, the responsibility is uncertain. Government, civil society, medical profession, legal profession. But remember, we have to understand that this is, at the heart of it, individual human suffering. And the problem is that everybody's business is nobody's business. So we were very fortunate that in 2015, Indian Academy of Neurology, thanks to Gagandeep's support, the Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine and the Indian Association of Palliative Care could come together to form a task force, ELICIT, End of Life Care in India Task Force. And the responsibilities that we have are, first of all, of course, the legal framework. So we have prepared a draft legislation on end of life care. We've been involved with the Supreme Court. That's a common cause judgment that you've heard about. We worked with the ICMR, including very recently on the Do Not Attempt Resuscitation document, which you should see out soon. And obviously, there has been some involvement with educating the profession and some on public awareness. But at the end of it, I am a practicing neurologist with a special interest in epilepsy. And for me, I look at myself as a physician, proud of my membership of my profession. And as a physician neurologist, my responsibilities include diagnosis, therapeutics, and prognosis. And as physicians and neurologists, we are proud of our diagnostic skills. Of course, with therapeutics, what we can do is expanding, but we are still limited to conditions that have drugs with an evidence base. The problem is that when we realize that we cannot cure a patient's illness, this is unfortunately what we are forced to do, that we, in a way, abandon our patients. And we forget that our duty of care remains to be fulfilled. If I look at my own residents, I know that if I were to ask them about to write a short note on the complex genetics or diagnosis of a rare neuromuscular syndrome, they will promptly produce some amount of it. But if I were to ask them what is going to happen to him and his family over the next 10 years, they are lost, as I was earlier. Because we were never trained for this. And this lack of training makes us uncomfortable to the point that we really abandon our patients. And when our families or patients ask us, ab kya hoga? This is how we respond. You will have been undergoing many of these webinars. For instance, if you take the webinars on neurointervention, mechanical thrombectomy, there's hardly been anything on what happens to all those patients who do not get mechanical thrombectomy or who fail it. Nothing. So when we look on our responsibility as physicians, this is how we perform them. Diagnosis, better and getting better. Thera, part of it. And prognosis, nothing. And neurologists are involved with seriously ill patients where cure is not possible, all over the place. Sudden, when it is not death, catastrophic, severe acute brain injury, acute on chronic brain injury, terminal illnesses, brain tumors, progressive neurodegenerative disorders, all life-limiting neurologic illnesses, including my own field of epilepsy. Don't forget that people who have unremitting recalcitrant epilepsy have a high incidence of early death, Parkinsonian syndromes, MS, frailty and dementia, and then organ delirium. When a patient becomes encephalopathy, who do they call? The neurologist. So neurologists are involved everywhere, and we are responsible to our patients and their families. I'm going to quickly cover our issues in acute brain injury, for instance, in hypoxic ischemic, acute massive strokes, intracerebral hemorrhage, and to some extent, perhaps traumatic brain injury, though that's not really so much to do with us, but we do get involved. So let me introduce you to this patient of mine who I have now seen for quite a while. She came to me literally hours after her intracerebral hemorrhage. And you look at this and you know this is not going to go well. So one of my neurosurgical colleagues came in and agreed on the poor prognosis. But the family asked for a second consultation. And as the husband said, I want her back home. So she got a decompressive craniectomy fairly quickly. She was discharged with a tracheostomy and PEG. 2 weeks later, got decannulated. Even the PEG got removed. And as the neurosurgeon put it, he said, good result. So my duties in this situation are obviously best medical management, prognostication, rehabilitation, and palliation. So you can see I did 25% of it. And this was 3 years ago, now 4 years almost. I made three mistakes, which I will tell you about, which I no longer make. They were poor communication of prognosis, inadequate emphasis of the surrogate's role, and frankly, the neurosurgeon and the intensivist made decisions after a point. I did not. So, how do we get a framework for this? Biomedical ethics consists of autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice. And these are four basic principles which are said to be equal, with autonomy being the first amongst equals. But how do you exercise or support the patient's autonomy when the patient is not able to speak? And then what about beneficence? What is the patient's good? Who decides? What about justice? If for instance, we look at Aruna Shanbag, she got exceptional medical care, exceptional. But it was because, well, she was a nurse and her care was prioritized. So you could say that maybe there was an element of injustice to the rest of the patients, but yeah, but there was exceptional care. So the model that we use is called the four box model, and you'll get it free on the net. It puts together four elements, these four elements in different combinations. First is medical indications, which is beneficence, non-maleficence, and autonomy. Then patient's preferences, which is autonomy only, quality of life, which is beneficence and non-maleficence, and contextual features. And if you look through it, you can see various points that you can check. So, coming back to my patient, when somebody comes in with a severe neurological illness, a neurocritical illness, at that point, know that over a period of time, they may improve with disability. They may remain in a persistent vegetative state, and a certain proportion of them will die. And the decision-making points that we have in this situation are at four time slots. Mark that. The first is neurosurgical intervention, which is very early. Then a little later comes a question of brain death determination and can stretch up to a week. Then extending to 21 days is the question of tracheostomy or not. Because if you tracheostomize, you also do a PEG. And if you do not, then you have to make this a very explicit decision. This decision should not be lost, because after that, if you have to withdraw in a patient with persistent vegetative state or minimally conscious state, you have to dehydrate and starve them to death over a period of 10 to 14 days. And you can imagine how horrendously painful it is for everybody. So remember that when somebody comes in with medical coma, the chances of them going out with mild or no disability is as little as 10 to 15%. Severe disability, 10 to 15%. A small percentage remain in chronic disorders of consciousness, and a majority will die. Because initial prognosis is uncertain, beware of self-fulfilling prophecies, which is what I was about to push my patient into. And the rule is you give a trial of full intensive care therapy for first 24 to 72 hours, and you're looking at the possibility of neurosurgical salvage. If early withdrawal happens, as I said, it can happen up to 7 days. And what were my mistakes? My first mistake was a poor explanation of prognosis. I did not say that she will never be normal again. Remember that when patients, here not patients, families, look at these situations, for them, they are not doctors. They think that miracles are routine and patients come back to normalcy. Maybe not normal, but haan, theek to ho jayegi. And you have to give them a reality check. Look at the modified Rankin scale and you should be able to predict. But how do you predict? And how do you communicate this? Now, this paper looks at delivering this kind of information to families. And where are physicians and surrogates, concordant and discordant? Nobody wants false hopes. They're usually clear about that. But they want the prognosis to be delivered with compassion. And once they've made a decision, then they want you to support them. They don't want you to go on arguing with them. Where are we discordant? We as physicians are comfortable with uncertainty. We know that these things are not very certain. Surrogates are not. They want numeric estimates of prognosis. And that is where we are completely at sea, because we do not want to do that, because we think prediction scores don't work in the individual case, and that is true. So how do you square this triangle or square this circle? So this paper clarified my own thinking. This was a survey of anesthetists. And I'm sorry if there are anesthetists in this audience. Please understand that anesthetists are quintessential, superb medical technicians. They know every step, but they never see the beginning and the end. So about 80 odd anesthetists were shown, were given case scenarios of traumatic brain injury and shown the CT scans and asked, would you want a decompressive craniotomy for yourself if you were the patient? Now, data for this come from the crash and the other series, where literally you can get a numerical estimate for, if you put the details into it, you will get a numerical age, GCS, CT scan findings. And look at what happens when they are just given the case and the CT scan, and after that, when they're given the number. See how much of a change, even for doctors, it makes to their own decisions for themselves. So how can surrogates be different? Remember that till the middle of the last century, our three skills, as I said earlier, were diagnosis, therapeutics, and prognosis. But we are socialized against prognostication. This is because as patients have become more empowered, they expect us to prognosticate in a fashion that is simultaneously honest, accurate, and optimistic. And at one level, yes, it is impossible, but we can actually combine this if we are taught how to do it. Because if we don't, then we indulge in what is called magical thinking. This is a term that comes from child psychology. Agar main bura sochunga, to bura hoga. Agar main achha sochunga, to achha hoga. And then we ritualize optimism. Maji sab theek ho jayega. So, when you have to communicate prognosis, make rough estimates from the literature. And for neurologists, we have the advantage of diffusion weighted imaging. Look at oncologists. They have to predict survival duration. And when they do it, because it has been estimated carefully for them, they usually tend to err on the side of optimism. So make a intuitive estimate numerically. The more experienced you are, and even with a few years of experience, you will be able to do this, provided you do it. I mean, you make it a practice to do it. and then give them best case and worst case. So at best, less than 10% chance of being able to stay alone at home. At worst, maybe not even 50% chance of not even leaving the hospital. And so on. Do I make definitive statements? Yes. I make definitive statements like he, she will never be normal again. That is obvious. And if somebody is brain dead, I say very clearly, he's gone. Remember that traumatic brain injury is in a way the graveyard of prognosis, especially with younger individuals. And there is where you need to convey uncertainty most carefully. But as I said, that's usually not our business. My second mistake here was not explaining substitutive judgment. He said, husband said, I want a backup. What I should have said is, this is not about what you want. You are the person who knew her best. As a representative, you have to tell us what she would have wanted and asked him to think how she would be 6 months from now. So who decides when the patient cannot? Ideally, the patient should have decided in advance by something called advanced care planning and living wills, which is applicable to all of us at any age or any stage of health. But this talk is not about that. So I'm going to leave this aside. It is valid with some caveats in India. The problem is that they are not enforceable. And the Supreme Court has made a real mess of how to get it done. But nobody can stop you or any patient from making their wishes known to their family. And if you don't have it, then you have to go by the surrogate decision maker. And unfortunately, here again, we have no legislation on what the hierarchy is. No legislation, not even for the Human Organ Transplant Act. So we follow the family hierarchy, first spouse, then adult children, then siblings. But that leaves a question of people who do not have a nuclear family. Or the poor patient who comes in the casualty alone from the street. Whatever it is, you put this into something, a process called shared decision making. And this is a documented process where the best prognostic estimate of neurological estimate is combined with our knowledge of the quality of life and with what the patient and the family would want. And then you set goals of care through shared decision making. How do I do it? I follow something called the Spikes protocol, and I'll be talking about that a little later. This has to be a sit-down meeting. This cannot be done outside the ICU walking. Never. Either in the ICU side room, or I call them to my own consulting room. And I have a little trick. If it's in my consulting room, I let them wait. Because typically, the whole family will have assembled. That's the only time that all of them will be together, and they will actually talk amongst themselves. I let them sit and stew for at least half an hour or so. Then I make sure I introduce everyone is present. There is some due diligence which will have been done by my resident before that to confirm that all concerned are present, especially the person who's paying. And then I go through the explicit prognostication, and I'll tell you about the Spikes protocol also. How do you do that? If you do it right, it doesn't take longer than 15 minutes and it is over. You may require a follow-up meeting after some time for about 5-10 minutes. This has been documented by the palliative care department in AIMS, when they work with neurology. It just takes that much time. And nobody runs around behind you outside the ICU. Sir, sir, kya hoga, kya hoga? You do it right, it's over. It actually saves time. And as you go through this meeting, you should ask them if he or she had ever indicated wishes. It's uncommon, but it will change with public awareness. And one of her patients, the first line, she always used to say, this is what the family told me. She always used to say, Allah mujhe chalte firte le jaana. So these decisions become simple if the prognosis is terrible. So in certain neurocritical conditions and where advanced care planning is available. So what happened to my patient? She went through medical complications. She was treated for depression and she was on treatment for depression. But one day her husband was very, very down. They follow up with me regularly. So I sat him down and I spent a good 15-20 minutes talking to him. He used to run a business consultancy, closed that down, stopped traveling, and he became a full-time carer, and they could afford 24-hour nursing. The patient is wheelchair-bound. She's completely dependent for activities of daily life, but she's continent and she can feed herself. And she can speak. So, like all wives, well, she gives it to her husband. And this is what is getting him down. She says, remember that her left hemisphere is intact. She was a tennis player. She keeps telling me, why did you have me operated? Her brother actually came down a couple of days later and he was very upset at my decision. I have two daughters who have promised that they will take care of her when I am not there. But right now, I am all alone. So, this conversation needs to begin when the neurologic prognosis becomes clear, which is latest by day 3 to 5. And then you head into the next point at which withdrawal can happen. Latest by 21 days, which is when you have to convert the endotracheal tube to tracheostomy or do terminal or what we call palliative extubation and then go on. If you put in the tracheostomy, then you also go ahead and do a PEG. Now, this is a little tricky. I always have intensivists and neurosurgeons saying, kya hai usme? 3 din mein tracheostomy kar denge and we'll shift her out. And so we will take if the family wants to, we will take out the tracheostomy tube later. No, that is not how it works. Remember that withholding and withdrawing are morally, ethically, and legally equivalent. But for families and surrogates, withholding is emotionally easier. So when you frame this question as withholding tracheostomy, so you tell them that the tube, endotracheal tube has to be. But do you want to do a tracheostomy or not? It is morally much less troubling than the question of disconnecting a ventilator later. Please remember that. So if the family is not, and when the family is finding it difficult to make a decision, we hold this till as long as 21 days. The problem is, as I said earlier, neurosurgeons and intensivists are in a hurry and this is your patient. You hold control. So what about documentation? What about guidelines for withdrawal? And there is a whole amount of literature. So don't be afraid that this is something that you cannot do. Remember that the Aruna Shanbag case, the Supreme Court decriminalized withdrawal when futility is recognized. For brain death, it is very clear that you do not need to keep them on the ventilator. In fact, the only case that I know of is a consumer court case against a hospital which kept a brain dead patient on the ventilator. Doing right can never be illegal. Due process has to be followed and documentation has to be complete. Our own process has 3 steps. One is you have to get consensus between the involved consultants. Then you have to see that the hierarchy of surrogate decision makers is properly maintained and then complete documentation with a detailed note to be signed by the appropriate surrogates and at least 3 full hospital consultants. And we have a mandatory audit by a clinical ethics committee sometime later. And if you have any issues, let me tell you, Elicit is happy to help. Another quick point that I need to cover, remember that we are way behind the rest of the world. I'm not sure how many of you are aware of this concept called donation after cardiac death. So if somebody is not brain dead, but for either because the family has or the patient has an advanced care plan which asks for withdrawal, well, you can do a donation, but it has to follow the dead donor rule. So extubation happens in the OT with a harvest team on standby and the heart has to stop irreversibly and the period for that is about 3 minutes and that can take as long as 15-20 minutes for it to happen. And that is when organ harvesting begins. Currently, kidneys come out in good condition, but the boundaries are being extended and people are even getting the heart. And this mode of donation is actually bigger than brain dead donation in the Netherlands. What if the family chooses not to withdraw? Well, you have to support them. Typically, these are younger individuals, husband, wife. There's a deep relationship. They have a burden. We have told them that withdraw. So they are pushing for not withdrawing. And remember, the communication that you have in the beginning carries a significant long-term influence on how they trust you. You have to deal with long-term prognostic uncertainty, there is rehab and experimental therapies possible, but you're looking at long process of maintaining them. Now, every patient's family or situation is unique, and our responsibility is to do right and to be seen to be done right. You have to commit to shared decision making, support the family through the process, minimize their guilt if they decide to withdraw, and respect their commitment if they wish to continue. You have to be clear about the ethical and legal framework, and to put it all together, you need communication skills. Now, moving on to the bigger part of my talk, actually, which is actually palliative care. Palliative care is applicable to all serious health-related issues, and we were actually right now talking of end-of-life care, terminal care, and actively dying situations, which are months to years, weeks to months, and down to days. And I'm going to leave that aside for the time. Remember that when you manage a life-limiting neurologic illness, you pass through, and the patient passes through a diagnostic phase, a supportive phase, and a terminal phase. And this applies to all progressive illnesses. You may have been told that palliative care is only for terminal pain. I'm going to try and convince you that it is not. It is specialized medical care for all people with serious illnesses. It focuses on providing patients with relief of symptoms, pain, and the stress, whatever the etiology, the goal being to improve quality of life. It's best provided by a team who work with the patient's other doctors, and it is appropriate at any age and any stage, and can be provided together with curative and life prolonging therapies. Please mark my words, it goes together. Now, if you look at any patient in the early stage, they go through these multiple transitions. For some time, you are containing the disease, maintaining function, but eventually decompensation happens, and palliative care should come in at least by that time. Dependency and symptoms increase, then they go into a terminal phase, and then finally you come to death. And the first challenge is to deliver the diagnosis, which is something that we in India find extremely hard to do. So let me start with a story. This was an old lady who came into my consulting room. She must have been in her early 70s. She was brought in by her two children who were in her 40s. One look at her as she came in the wheelchair, and she had motor neuron disease. And she had been seen by two of my senior colleagues. So she came, the wheelchair came to my side. I did an examination because she could not be moved to the couch. Finished the examination, I had turned to her. Ki maji, aapko aapki bimari ke baare mein kya pata hai? And then the son jumps up and he quickly starts to pull the wheelchair out of the door. And from the door, these are words that I'll never forget. In her dysarthric voice, she says, "Mujhe kya ho raha hai? Mujhe batao." And she's gone. So then the son comes back, son and daughter, and I tell them, "Ki, what are you doing? She's losing her voice. She needs to know." So they say, "We'll come back." And I have given some investigations to be done. And a week later, the son comes back. And when he comes, he says, "Haan, ho gaya, family mein discuss kara, aur hamare tauji ne kaha ki ab unko bata ke takleef kyun dena." Anyway, I got the rest of the story also out. She had been widowed when she was in her 20s. She had brought these two kids up alone, never taking any help from anybody. And I told the son, "You're taking her independence away after she had held on it for 50 years. 2 weeks later, he came back again. The old lady had died because she closed her mouth and with whatever strength she had, stopped eating and drinking. She died with her children, but they did not hear her. So, remember that in the Indian context, to tell or not tell is always an issue. This has been studied for oncology. There's a recent paper from Tata Memorial Hospital from my friends. Patients, more than 80% want to know all the details, but well under 40%, a small minority of caregivers are willing to tell them that. Why is this? And this is true across the world. Safety is what we want for those whom we love, but autonomy is what we want for ourselves. And there is something in between which the doctor has to sort out. And we give in to this because usko mat batao is rubbish that we support because we do not know how to deliver bad news. It takes very little time and a certain amount of skill, but it needs a commitment to the craft of medicine and to training and communication skills. This delivery of bad news can be protocolized. It's called the Spikes protocol. And if anybody is interested, this paper is also free on the internet. You need to get the setting right. You need to find out what the patient and the family know already. Confirm that they want to know. Then give information. So remember these first three steps. Then give information. Then deal with emotions. And you need to be prepared and you need to know how you will handle it. So I'll come a little to that also. And then you close. How I do it? Well, in the first consultation, I give the correct name of the possible disease. I say it's a possible diagnosis. Say, take for instance, ALS, MND. I acknowledge diagnostic uncertainty, suggest a second opinion, and direct them to a colleague whom I can rely on. Don't say, kisi ko bhi dikhao. Then before ending the first consultation, in the presence of the family, I specifically ask the patient, do you want to talk to me about this illness or would you prefer X, Y, Z? And then I insist on a second appointment for discussing the diagnosis and then implications and then go through the second consultation with the Spikes protocol. This is the responsibility of the first doctor making the diagnosis. When the family is hit with this diagnosis, they are shell-shocked. And it is then that this support matters. This is what I tell them. It is my duty to inform the patient. This is not your job or responsibility, it is mine. And the immediate family promptly says, aap karo. It's only when it goes into the wider family and the whole story comes in of our cultural biases that it becomes the tauji and the masiji and everybody come into it and it becomes a mess. Remember that the patient and you are embarking on the last journey of a life. You cannot build a therapeutic alliance with the patient without telling the truth. And this is an ongoing commitment. Patients again and again ask me, and I tell them, keep main aapse kuch nahi chupaunga. Because when you conceal and collude, you begin the process of abandonment. And here comes the crucial role of comm skills. Four pictures. Two Kapoors, Kareena and Sanjeev. This is a family photo. My sister and her Mexican friend have put together a fantastic Spanish meal. And here from the internet is a picture of three young cooks who think they are going to make a great cake. So this is the Dunning-Kruger effect. And this has been shown across professions whenever it's a question of skill. When you can't have an app for it, when you have to depend on skills that you acquire. When you really know nothing and you embark on it, you swiftly think that, well, you can do it all. Then you go through the valley of despair before you start hitting the slope of enlightenment. Why does this happen? This is because at the peak of Mount Stupid, you're looking at a guru. The guru makes it look simple. And you underestimate learned skill components. I know my journalist friends tell me that this applies to writing. It applies to cooking and applies to speaking. And what do you do if you fail badly at a learned skill? Well, give it up. If you can afford to, you hire a driver or a cook. Or you flail about ineffectually because you don't know that you can learn this and also because everyone around you is also terrible. Or you accept the necessity and begin the process of learning. So what about Karuna Kapoor Khan? Where does she come into it? I don't know if she can make chapatis or not. But she very definitely, she's very clear. She doesn't do the cooking in the house. She doesn't have whatever. No time, no inclination, whatever. So if you're a senior professor in neurology or wherever, you don't have to talk to the relatives. Your senior registrar can do that. But if you are a consultant in a busy hospital, this is actually a statement from a senior physician colleague of mine. Just after I had gone to meet the same neurotic husband, whom I had spoken to for exactly 15 minutes, and we were both on the same page, and who still refused to except that his communications with skills were terrible. I said it tactfully, but he didn't accept it. And remember, there is no app for communication skills. Like all learned skills, surgical, diagnostic, they have to be, you have to be trained with mentorship and supervised. then you practice and you reflect on your practice. And then finally you're assessed and certified. If you do this, then you hit the slope of enlightenment. And eventually, hopefully, you become a guru where you prepare for a procedure. You perform the procedure. After the procedure is done, you reflect on it. Think where you went wrong. Then go back better the next time. And hopefully, in one of these talks, we'll have my own guru, Dr. Nagesh Sinha. This is him receiving. He's a surgeon. Now, of course, he does palliative care, but he's receiving his FRCP for palliative care with his wife, Jayashree. But then communication skills, as with the physician friend of mine, you can take a horse to the water. You can't make them drink. You have to want to do it. So think about it for yourself. How good are your communication skills? Without teaching, without practicing as a procedure, and without any assessment. Think about it. Okay. So let's move on to the main bulk of continuum of palliative care. So you get a patient, say, with multiple sclerosis. And over a period of time, the curative, the restorative therapies gradually begin to fail. And you are moving on to relieving suffering, improving quality of life, until eventually, and this has happened to me, you actually see a patient coming to the end of the road. And then you also have to handle the family after that. What we don't realize is that symptoms in oncology and non-oncology, the burden is roughly about the same. Our patients, neurology patients, often lose voice. Whereas in oncology, patients have voice. They can speak almost till the end. And that is where our patients really are very badly served. So if you were to look at the incidence of symptoms in non-cancer, literally all of them are about the same. And in the same, roughly the same frequency of physical symptoms, pain, nausea, vomiting, dyspnea, constipation, weakness, loss of appetite, tiredness, problems with activities of daily life, psychological problems, emotional strain, social problems, the worry about burdening the family. So there is an approach to handling this. It's called the EMA approach: evaluation, explanation, management, monitoring, and attention to detail. And this too will come in one of these talks. But more than that, you have to be prepared to foresee. And there are three triggers that you should not miss. The first is a surprise question. Intuitively, if you are asked, would you be surprised if this patient were to die in the next few months, weeks, days? It's an intuitive answer. And as you get more experience, you get better and better at it. But it has been shown across the world that it is close to, in an experienced doctor, it can reach 80 to 90% accuracy. Then general indicators of decline. The family is often not aware that the patient who was walking, talking, is now bed or chair bound, is now increasing needs in self-care. Or sometimes the patient herself says, I don't want dialysis. Then, of course, you have specific indicators linked to the diagnosis. Pretty good for COPD and heart failure. Not so good for dementia, but still there. And with all the best, when you do this prediction, say, a little far out, maybe for about 6 months to a year, the error rate is about 30%, which is related to clinical experience, not really to qualifications. But if you do it, you will be surprised how quickly you come up to speed. And when you embark on neuropalliative care, remember that these are specific skill sets that you need to acquire. Prognosis, we've spoken about. Preference-sensitive decisions. Every patient, every family, every disease will have its own preferences. And you have to elicit these accurately by listening more than you tell them. One of the rules of communication skills is that the patient talks 80%, you talk 20%. You have to be very, very clear about shared decision-making. Hyper-vigilant. See that they are involved. You have to detect and manage whole body pain. And that's a term I'm going to not explain further, except that it applies to everything, including the social pain. And then go on to managing end of life. This paper is available free on the net, written by my colleague. I don't know if you remember her from the second or third picture, that slide that I showed you. Maisha Robinson. She's a neurologist and she runs the palliative care unit there. The EPEC, Education in Palliative End of Life Care, will be starting off a dedicated course for neurology, which I am involved with. and we hope to put it out by the beginning of 2021. It will be available. We will run it for a full year. We will probably have a contact session middle of the year. It's something that all of you can do. But we have one more responsibility as clinicians who can influence the way medicine is organized around us. This is a bit of reminiscence. I passed my MD medicine in 1984 and DM neurology in 1988. When I qualified in medicine, we would refer patients to nephrology only when creatinine crossed 10 because dialysis equaled death. Now, when do we refer? At creatinine 1.4. When I qualified in neurology, we had no intensive ICU. So we ourselves intubated and ventilated. And now I shudder to think of how we did it. So think of a specialty that can dialyze your patient's family's minds and intubate your patient's soul. I'm not qualified in palcare, so I depend on Hinduja Hospital's two consultants in palliative medicine. And you can see both of them. I hope they're listening in. And there are lots of things that palliative care physicians wished that we knew about palliative care. And again, this is a paper that is free on the internet. And I suggest you read it because I've seen it happening. For instance, Dr. Jayarajan attends the ICU morning round. So he's in on helping the ICU. Of course, the registrars are very quick to involve him. The consultants, much less. But it is happening. They assist with complex symptom management. They assist with complex medical decision making and future planning needs. They speak to patients and families. For instance, I've had a complex consent where Dr. Jayarajan spent time and I could get away in 2 minutes. They control symptoms. Remember that symptom burden in neurology patients is as much as in oncology, but our patients have no voice. And the commitment is to add life to days, not days to life. So some closing suggestions. This is a quote from my friend Benzie Kluger. Remember that typically when you say a patient stopped following up, how often are you aware that they actually died? There are various trajectories of death. And our patients follow all these three trajectories that have been documented for various illnesses. We have to be prepared to learn the care of severely ill patients over time, shared decision-making, setting goals of care, finding solutions for future planning needs, managing symptoms. And of course, this will vary depending on the situation you're in. If you are in solo practice, then you need to learn some of these skills yourself. And as I said, we will have this accessible. But if you are in a hospital or corporate setting, you need to push your hospital management to set up palliative care as a distinct specialty. And if anybody wants any advice on how I could do it at Hinduja, well, you know where to come. You have to be prepared to foretell. Because these questions, once you're honest, come. How long have I got? How long will she suffer? But the question that has to come from the patient or the family, if I or we do not have long, then what should we do and how can you help us? This is not something that you, as your communication skills improve, they will ask you. Never say, main kuch nahi kar sakta. When I started on this journey about 3 or 4 years ago, I didn't know how far it would change me in my practice and as a person also. And as I said earlier, saying main kuch nahi kar sakta was something that would hurt me. But I had no choice but to say it. My colleagues in my hospital think that, well, I'm sure somebody behind my back has called me Yamdut. That is not the way it is. I don't beckon Yamdut. I don't even open the door for Yamdut. But I prepare my patient. And I am prepared. When Yamdut knocks on the door, I let him enter. And we complete the handover with as much grace and dignity as is possible. And when my patient or family says, ab kya hoga? I can take his hand, their hand and say, main hoon na, aakhir tak. Thank you. Anybody who's interested?
Thank you, Roop, for that wonderful talk.
I'll stop sharing at this point.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Roop, for the wonderful talk. Before I give it to Dr. Kothari.
No, Param, why don't you take the question answers?
Okay. All right. My name is Param Kharbanda. I'm a professor of neurology and epileptology at PGI Chandigarh. And I also take care of the communication in healthcare for PGI, sometimes for the Indian Academy of Neurology and Indian Epilepsy Society, and now with the neuropalliative group with Dr. Roop. So thank you, Dr. Roop, for a wonderful, comprehensive talk. We'll go on to the few questions which people have asked. I just wanted to make a couple of points based on what you said, the challenges which I have faced during these communication sessions. So one is the shared decision making. As you rightly said, we need to involve the patient. So many times in our culture, the patients are not confident enough to take their own call. So this is all of us would have said, after you tell everything, the patient comes, doctor sahab, aapko jo theek lagta hai, wo kar do. So although we want patients to take their own call, sometimes if they are, because they're very anxious, especially if it's a bad news thing, they are not in the right sense of mind. So we need to sometimes hold their hand. So what I do in that case is if after everything they're not able to say, I say, okay, I can tell you what to do, but maybe if I was in your position today, maybe I would have done that. So this sometimes helps this trick. The second point was, regarding telling the breaking bad news, you said regarding the family and patient ko batana nahi batana is a big issue in our society. So during my time, I realized that instead of having, when you have the like a ALS MND report in your hand, and that is the time you want to discuss patient wants to know or not, maybe before we do the test, when the patient doesn't know and we don't know, that is the time we talk to the patient that whatever comes, who wants to know, would you want to know? Or your family, that becomes a little more transparent and helpful. So, Dr. Roop, there are a few questions here. So want to read them and answer? Yeah.
No. You go ahead. I mean, it's much better that way. The only thing is, I didn't bring up this point, and I suppose when we do communication skills a little later, this will come up. And that is what you said is a warning shot.
Yeah. Absolutely.
The warning shot, whether you deliver it at the time of, and this I've heard, this is tossed around, whether it is done at the time when you are beginning to make the diagnosis or when the patient comes with the report. Yeah, but you have to be, it's best if you deliver the warning shot in advance.
True. And there is, is it necessary it is necessary to us to acknowledge whether the patient is ready to understand his own prognosis for ALS. I think we've already discussed that question, that you need to build a rapport first and then kind of invite the patient and know how much the patient wants to know. The outcome be communicated at first visit in face manner. I think you answered that again. There is a case scenario if you would want to go into it, is about, I think, communication failure between two teams, the ICU team and the neurologist. This is from Dr. Advait Kulkarni. So if we have time, maybe you could go into this. I'm just going through the questions.
We'll go to the other questions and then go to this later.
Yeah, in the public sector, because of no financial burden, patient attendant wants to continue to stay in hospital. How to communicate to them? And that is a very important question these days. I wish we have time for that because of the COVID thing. Now, it's very different. The palliative care in normal circumstances is only about the patient. In COVID times, it could be because of lack of resources, ventilator. And that is going to be a very challenging communication for us because this is a very, very unique scenario of withholding ventilatory support or something. Do you want to talk about that when the patient wants to continue and you think there's no point in continuing?
So, yes, with the COVID thing, in New York and in Italy, they've already been faced with this, the question of rationing. And for you in a public health system, maybe a little less for us, but definitely for you, that is going to come up. And if anybody is interested, look up Vital Talks, vitaltalks.org. They have scripts. Remember that when you do this kind of discussion, one of the problems is that, and we will do communication skills also, that you have to prepare your own scripts which you run repeatedly. Now, my residents, for instance, have heard mine so often that they can, this, I think they start to laugh when they hear me speak about them. But if you use them and you're comfortable with them and they work, which you will find out, you can modify it from what you can get another, but you have to develop these scripts, the words to use. Right.
Isn't it, how about giving optimum written information from Dr. Sudhir Shah? It's giving written information and video and authentic sources between the first and the second consultation to the relatives and the patient, so the next consult is focused. I think that's a very relevant point, that when you are into things, rather than giving everything in a one go and shocking the patient, you give something and then ask them to read and come back. It doesn't have, the bad news hasn't to be done everything in first go. You can give patient time to think about, take back written information, read and come back. It's a valid point, I guess.
But 1 minute, is it, suppose somebody has motor neuron disease, then to give him a link and he goes and reads that motor neuron disease is not treatable and you're going to die, and is it better that they read, or you should tell? I think you should tell.
No, so the way we do it, you say it's a possible diagnosis. So the warning shot has gone in when you're sending the patient off to the investigation, that we will probably need to talk in detail about this. When the possible diagnosis comes up, they've already seen the report. That's the stage at which I ask them. I mean, if they want to know more and they're willing to look at the net, I offer them the resources. And that's when they also go off to the other consultant for confirmation. Now, that's a luxury that in Mumbai I have. Not everybody is going to have that. And then the last stage is when they come back with all of that, and then the spikes protocol really is taken on to the last. And usually that is the stage where thoda bahut rona dhona hota hai and stuff like that. So it's actually staggered over three. Now, remember when I told you about the outside the ICU, that is one single 15-minute thing, because that is a situation. And there you have the surrogate, not the patient. But when you're dealing with a more complex scenario, then let it evolve over time. And you don't have to tell them that they're going to have bulbar impairment. You tell them that the commitment is actually to the honesty. And once that is understood, they also don't want to hear it in the beginning. As long as they know that you will not hide anything from them. That commitment, once that is made, then my patients follow up until weeks before death. How? Because they know there is always something that they get out of that encounter. But then we are, in a sense, I'm more and more prepared. I'm prepared emotionally myself. It's something that takes us time to get into.
I think we have multiple questions. I think you stimulated a lot of thought process. So before I go on to the question, I want to talk to you and Dr. Kothari. Are we recording these questions? Will be saved somewhere, because I'm not sure if you'll be able to take all of them. They're all very good questions about communication mainly, and also about palliation. Maybe you'll need more sessions than this to answer this, and you need to start planning about this. Oh. And so let's save these questions. But if we have a couple of minutes, I will give you
one.
Do you want to say something, Dr. Kothari?
Yeah, the questions are being saved. And I have told Roop to take at least 3 or 4 sessions. So he is going to
So the plan is that we have at least 2 more Tuesdays till lockdown ends. And we will have one international authority come in, and we will have 2 national authorities come in. So, so we'll have a session on communication skills and symptom management.
I can see a lot of questions on communication.
Yeah, so that will happen. Nagesh, I'll try and confirm and see if I can get him. And then I'll get somebody international to put it together as a neurologist and a palliative care specialist, how they take the whole thing together. So we'll finish in 3 talks, and those questions, I think if Mansi can just save them, and I will go over them over a period of time, because next time I will be able to sort them out and put them across to the other authorities. Right? So
the question
is, I'll save them.
We still have 3 minutes. So Ramdeep, do you want to?
So is it right to say that, you know, particularly in our branch of Western medicine, we have become too much of diagnosticians. We have forgotten that we have to be healers, we have to be advisors, and that is where sometimes the other pathies seem to score on us.
I think they only score on one thing. They spend time and they listen. And they are, by their inherent nature, they know that they have to convey uncertainty. Whereas we think we are know-it-alls. We are going to tell them everything. No. You have to embrace that uncertainty with the family.
And it's difficult to not be judgmental when you think a person, sometimes I find myself getting angry. I feel there's a patient who can be saved, who is worth, I feel, trying, but then the family sort of gives up. But they give up in a peculiar way. They don't want to stop things, but they don't want to continue. Very difficult to face that situation.
I think again, you practice holding that sit-down meeting and you do it systematically. You have to do it systematically. It is never, I'm repeating this, never standing up outside the ICU. Never.
No, but Roop, what I mean is this standing...
So if you do it, you do it systematically.
Can I say something on this, Dr. Kothari? Very valid question. So about family being midway to that, we see it many times. One is they want to do also and they want to agree with you also, but they have the guilt of not doing enough.
Yes.
That is a big problem in the family. So what I do always is if wherever possible, even if they could not afford an IVIG or something, end of then putting one sentence that you never don't think you didn't do your best. Things may not have changed even if we did more things. Yeah. So, and you did what you could, always sets them for future remorse is decreased. So this is part of our duty to tell them and make their guilt a little less.
Yeah. That's something that you have to tell them, you have to handle their sense of guilt. It's explicit. You have to do it.
But my problem is when you feel they're not doing their best, you feel. What do you do? How do you you handle that feeling? You see, you feel the patient can be helped. You feel the family can help. But they have given up prematurely. So that sit-down meeting is not just to convince the family. It is to convince me also, I think, that, okay, this is how much they want. I cannot decide.
Yeah.
We'll need to take that up at some time. Yeah. Dr. Gosani, this is a very important thing. One of the future meetings.
So, great.
Okay, Roop, good.
I was very impressed. They were actually at the peak. There were 150 partisans.
170.
There will be more next time. I always say that neuropalliative, the palliative word I don't like. I think it makes you think that this is all only end of life and thing. It is not.
Call it supportive care.
Yes, it is care and caring for your patient beyond diagnosis. So something like that, you need to change the terminology. But great talk. Thank you. Param, thank you.
Sorry we couldn't take all the questions. We've noted the questions as you might have heard and we'll get back to you.
Yes, they'll be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Bye, Param. Thanks.
Bye.